Hi, my name is Simone Marcantonio, and I'm a cancer blogger. My blog is called Breast in the City. I was diagnosed with stage 3 breast cancer in November of 2013. I started writing a blog during chemotherapy in February 2014, and I really enjoyed it because I read a lot of blogs and I found them helpful, and I thought, well, maybe I can do this too. So I started a blog, and I found it very emotional but great at the same time to be able to inform my family and friends on how I was doing and, you know, my progress throughout my treatments and getting back to work after being off for 2 years and 3 months, and just my story about you know, what I went through and how I dealt with it. So Breast in the City started off as a blog, but now I'm turning it, well, I'm going to keep blogging, but I'm turning it in also into a foundation to help women in our community who are financially challenged while they're receiving breast cancer treatments. So this is new for me, and it's going to take a few months and a while, but I'm happy to do that because I feel well and I feel like I need to give back in a meaningful way, since I got such great support from the hospital and family, friends, colleagues, neighbors. So yeah, I just feel like it's important to tell stories and, you know, to share what I've been through and to help others. So this is a video of me interviewing Dr. John Bell. He's a cancer researcher in Ottawa, and he's been studying this type of treatment for the last 15
years. Your busy schedule to come and speak to me, it means a lot to me as a cancer survivor. So in layman's terms, like at a street level, can you explain to me exactly what you're exploring in your lab?
Sure. So we've been, for a long time, trying to find new kinds of therapies to treat cancer. So as you know, current therapies are not as specific as they need to be. They attack the cancer, but they also attack normal tissues and people who suffer from those side effects. So what we've been trying to do is design things that are very targeted. When they attack the cancer, they leave all your normal tissues alone. And during the time that we did this, we sort of did a lot of molecular analysis, genetic analysis of various kinds of cancers and normal tissues, and we discovered that there's a difference between these two, and that difference could be exploited therapeutically. And the difference we discovered was that cancers in general are weak when it comes to virus infections. So they've given up certain genetic properties in order to become a cancer in the first place, and that leaves them weak so they can be infected and killed by viruses. But normally they're deep within your body, and they never see a virus because you filter viruses at your nose and in, you know, at your skin and so on. So our idea is to create viruses that we can inject into people that swim around inside the person. Whenever they found a cancer tissue, they'd infect it and grow in it and destroy it, and then hopefully have an effective outcome. But they would not infect normal tissues, and so patients don't get any of the side effects that they see with chemo and radiation. So that, in a nutshell, is how we've approached the problem. About what we call biotherapeutics, biologically based therapeutics, as opposed to chemical or radiation therapeutics.
Right. Okay. So will this replace the traditional protocol for treating cancers, such as chemotherapy and radiation and surgeries, etc.?
You know, that's our dream. Mm-hmm. That's not going to be any time in the near future, but of course that's what we're aiming for. Get something that's better than the current therapies so that people have better outcomes and they actually end up having the treatment regime itself is safer and less toxic. So that would be our dream. It's not in the near future. What we've discovered as we've done this work, though, is that there's a lot of aspects of the patient's immune system where they actually react against their own cancer. And so that seems to us as a really good idea, because then the patient can fight their own cancer. So with our approach, that's really enhanced. Unfortunately, with radiation and chemotherapy, it suppresses your immune system, so it doesn't have that opportunity. So we'd really like to change that if we can, and focus more on biological therapies that stimulate, you know, cancer immunity.
Right, okay. That's really interesting. So So you're injecting people with vaccines?
With viruses.
Viruses.
Yeah, well, we call them vaccines
okay.
too. Yeah.
And they're genetically engineered vaccines from like human cell tissue?
Yeah, so well, what we've done is there's a variety of different approaches.
Okay.
Not just my lab, around the world are using to try to stimulate immunity with the patient.
Okay.
And so what we are doing is we're actually taking viruses which we know are safe, and then we engineer them, we treat them like little machines, and we make them so the only place they can possibly grow is in a cancer. And then we inject them into your body, they swim around, and they find mm-hmm. the cancer. Did you ever see the movie Fantastic Voyage? I don't know if you ever saw it.
No.
Anyhow, it's a Raquel Welch movie from a long time ago.
No.
And anyhow, she basically they put them in a submarine and shrunk the submarine down and injected into this guy. And, you know,
it
around.
Swam around.
Yeah, so that's the same concept
yeah.
in a sense. We're making little biological machines of these viruses.
Mm-hmm.
And we inject them into the body and they swim around looking for cancers and then they attack directly.
Okay, so I saw that on the Vice documentary. I thought their visual
yeah.
of what it does was amazing because
yeah.
you saw it swimming through the vein and then going right to the... So for like a cancer, like a blood cancer that's all over, mm-hmm. how does that work? It works the same way, like myeloma yeah. or leukemia?
Yeah, something like that. It would be similar. In some ways, maybe easier because it's already in the blood.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and so
okay.
maybe... So, but really right now, the focus we have, at least, is on not blood cancers, but on more on solid tumors. And really, but we feel it's important to give it intravenously, because as you know, when people come to the cancer center, if we could do things with surgery, that's great,
yeah.
maybe cure people. But if they come in and there's lots of disease all over their body that we can't see, that's the problem.
Yeah, where it's hiding.
It's hiding. And so by giving it through the blood vessel, the virus can go everywhere.
Yeah.
And wherever that cancer's hiding, it can potentially find it.
Yeah.
Effective.
Right.
And so that's the dream. That's what we're hoping will happen. But and layered on top of that is this fact that these viruses, well, you know, whenever you get a cold,
yep.
you feel sort of crappy for a while.
Yeah.
It's because your immune system is fighting the cold.
Right.
And so we're just taking that same system and making it so that the cancer has the cold and the immune system is attacking that cancer only.
Okay.
And so that's really the dream here is that we'll stimulate immunity and then the cancer, which normally is invisible to your immune system, becomes visible.
And it starts attacking it. So your own immune system is attacking.
And you're fighting your own cancer.
Right. Okay, that's really cool.
Yeah.
When will these vaccines make it past the clinical trial stage to like worldwide use by the medical oncologists? Mm-hmm. Like, will we see this in our lifetime?
Oh, for sure. Like,
yeah.
So actually, last year,
okay,
a virus was approved as a therapeutic for melanoma.
Okay.
So the FDA approved it, it's also approved in Europe. So that's now being used for patients with melanoma.
Really?
Yeah, and in combination with other immune stimulating therapy. So this is starting to happen already.
Okay.
For sure. And so I think you're just going to see over the next few years more and more of these things becoming approved and being more mainstream type therapeutics. And it's going to be still a long period of bringing them all into usage. But we've gotten past it. So it's been a watershed moment with the approval of the first virus last year.
Okay, so what virus was it?
It's actually a herpes virus.
Herpes?
Yeah, it was actually, in fact, the original herpes virus was actually isolated off the lip of a technician who worked with this friend of mine, Rob Coffin, in England.
Oh,
and
cool.
And then he took it and he engineered it.
Yeah.
And then that's been many years into testing, and it was finally purchased by a company called Amgen. And it's now been tested in very large trials and shown to have therapeutic benefit for some kinds of melanoma patients. And so now it's been approved and is available at least in the United States and Europe for physicians to use.
Okay. And the success rate, that's what's so amazing about all this. For someone like we were just discussing, late stages who, you know, their chance of survival has become very minimal, and this is sort of like their last resort, and they get the...
Right. They get on some trials.
They get in a trial, yeah. And then within, you know, they're injected. Well, this is what I've learned from the Vice documentary, which we'll talk about more in a bit, but that they get in the trials, and within, I think it's 21 or 28 days, there's no sign of cancer.
You know, it's patient-specific, and it depends upon the indication, but there certainly have been some really outstanding results with some of these immune therapies.
Right.
The things you would have seen in the Vice documents, the work from Carl June in Philadelphia, which is quite
I'm going to ask you about.
Yeah, it's quite outstanding stuff. So that's really, again, using a biological approach, using cellular material instead of viral material, but it's again, immune therapies.
Okay.
Doesn't work for everyone yet.
No.
It's got a long ways to go, but we at least in some people who really have advanced disease, we're seeing remarkable outcomes. So that's really a change from what we've seen in the past.
Right. So I don't know if you could tell me which patients is it working for? Like, is there something different, like age, sex?
Maybe.
Like type of cancer?
Yeah, I think that, you know, for the Carl June's work, it's more about kinds of leukemia.
The types, okay.
And there's certain kinds of leukemia that are very responsive to that, okay. that therapy. Others not so much. And so that's why there's still a lot of work to be
right.
done.
Right.
You know, we don't want to give anybody the impression that we've solved the problem yet.
No.
That certainly hasn't happened. You know, in some kinds of solid cancers, like melanoma, for instance, with these other antibody-mediated immune modulators, we're seeing, again, people with very advanced disease having great responses. In the virus approach, especially viruses in combination with these other antibodies, we're beginning to see really some suggestions of really strong activity. So it's a lot of work to be done yet, for sure. But what I would say is different in my career, as I've looked over my career, in the past, we didn't see these sorts of dramatic changes in mm-hmm. patients and in such a high number of patients. So mm-hmm. I think this really suggests that this is
going
to be
It's
different.
Going in the right direction.
Yeah,
it's very, very positive outcomes. Okay, amazing. So, what should a patient who wants to get into one of your trials, what should they know? Like, what steps would they have to take to be involved?
So clinical trials are really important.
Mm-hmm.
And right now, when patients have exhausted all their treatment options and there's nothing else for them to attempt, they can go on to clinical studies. And this is where experimental therapeutics get tested. I think they're important for patients because it gives them another line of potential opportunity mm-hmm. and hope. I mean, a lot of times, you know, the trials really are experimental. We don't know what's going to happen. But nonetheless, I think that the patients can benefit from that. They can get at least really good attention and care from the medical staff as well. And one never knows how it's going to turn out. But they are experimental,
mm-hmm.
so patients should go into them knowing that this may not work.
Yep.
What I would say is, you know, I've spoken to many patients, and they often say, you know, this may not work for me, but maybe you'll learn something from it. I think it's almost universal what they say. So they're really brave people who go on the trial.
Yeah.
They want to contribute, give something
give
back.
Give help, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And they're hopeful, of course.
Yeah.
Hope for them, too. There's no question.
Yeah.
At the same time, they say maybe...
They're realistic.
Yeah. You'll learn something from this. It'll help my son, daughter, whatever. So I think that's really great. So they should try. I think I'd encourage people, if they're up for it, to try clinical studies and look for ones, talk with their oncologist and look for ones that make sense for them and see if there's another shot before,
right.
before they have to sort of give up on it.
Yeah. Do you get a lot of requests? Like, are you overwhelmed, or is it you're looking for people?
No, we get a lot of requests.
Yeah.
And, you know, I personally am not involved in the decisions
right.
to make about patients getting on study. We have a separate group of people who look at the patients who come in
right.
and decide if they should be on the trial or not. And but there is a huge need. There's no question, as you well know, in the world there's a huge need.
Right.
And so there's lots of people who are looking for something.
Yeah.
And I think that clinical trials are an option that and unfortunately not all people can even
Yeah, you have to qualify, right?
Yeah,
there's criteria.
Status.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
it's not for everybody.
No, it's not for everyone. But it's definitely I mean they can always inquire and
yep.
and look into
and they should.
The yeah, as, okay.
I think
that's
they should.
Good to know
yeah.
because you know yeah. Wonderful. This all sounds so exciting. So as a world leader in this field, have you experienced some frustration along the way? Can you tell me how you address these issues?
Well, you know, science can sometimes seem slower than you want it to be,
right.
to be truthful. I think that, you know, having worked in a long time in this field, I wish things would happen faster, but I also recognize that they should be done in a managed and safe way
mm-hmm.
because you don't want to, you know, just because I have an idea doesn't mean it's right.
Yeah.
And so we really have to test that carefully in people. I would like to see things happen faster. I'd like more people to have access to studies, but there's also some just logistical and financial limitations.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's frustrating to me that we haven't done more things than we have, but we have also made a lot of progress. So, sort of.
So, could you share with me what made you choose this career?
You know, it's, I think I'm sort of a naturally curious sort of person.
Yeah.
I like to solve problems. And, you know, I did a PhD in biology, which I find very fascinating.
Mm.
All about genetics and understanding how we're all put together. I find that always really, really cool. And then when I finished my PhD and was beginning to develop my own research career, I thought, you know, cancer is such a huge problem, and it's only gotten bigger. And of course, we all know people who've been affected by it. You can see what an impact it has on society. So I thought, you know, if you're going to work your butt off, you might as well do it for a good reason. Mm-hmm. And so certainly, you know, I've really enjoyed it. It's a challenging career, but the other thing that's sort of neat about this career is you meet lots of really bright young people every day. So it's really, you get to do what you want to do, and you get to sort of pursue your dream and work with brilliant people from around the world. So what's not to like? It's really actually a lot of fun. Yeah. And at the same time, I feel that we're making, as a community, we're making great progress towards solving this problem. So that also feels pretty good.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, you've become so successful that it's wonderful. And then you're teaching the next generation to take it over.
That's right. It's great. Lots of really smart people come to the lab.
Yeah.
And it's really just, you know, feed off their energy and their ideas. It's really, really a great career.
It's wonderful. So my next question is a loaded question, but I can't resist asking you.
Okay.
So how is Big Pharma involved in all of this? So we know that they have a vested interest in drug production.
Sure.
They have been involved in translating, have they been involved in translating these therapies forward? And if so, how?
For sure, pharma is critical to this. I mean, we the way the whole ecosystem has evolved is pharma's gotten less and less interested in doing research themselves. And what they sort of depend upon is universities and research institutes to come up with new discoveries. So this immunotherapy, as an example, really emerged from a lot of academics working in various universities around the world and sort of developing them. Once you get to a stage where you're showing activity and it looks like it's interesting, then pharma can come in and they can really put a lot of energy and resources towards driving these things through the clinic faster. So they have to play a really critical role. I think it's different than it used to be. They used to be more themselves doing the research, but that's sort of passed.
Oh, yeah.
And they recognize that there's a lot of, because of the bright young people in academia and so on, that's the place to let discoveries percolate up. And then once they get to a certain stage, then you come in. So for instance, the immune therapies have been taken over by large pharma companies like Merck and Bristol Myers Squibb, who are really pushing those immunotherapies as fast as they can through the clinic, playing a critical role in getting that to win.
Okay.
So I mean, there's always the, you know, academic industry butting heads, but I think we've changed that over the years, and we're much more cooperative, and I think pharma has a vested interest in, as you say, but they also want to see good therapies come out.
Right. So do they fund any of your projects? You're funded by industry
Okay. Mostly funded by CIHR.
Okay.
And Canadian Cancer Society, Terry Fox, OICE, the Ontario Institute for Cancer Research. That really is where the money comes from.
The NGOs and the federal.
That's right, really.
Okay, funding.
The pharma companies put money in after you got to the stage where you're in the clinic and it looks like it's going to
work. It could work, okay.
So then they're quite happy to put in, which is appropriate because that's very big money that we never get from
NGOs. Okay.
Yeah. So the way it really seems to be working is that we get as much money as we can from NGOs, get ourselves positioned, test these therapies, hopefully in the clinic as soon as you can, and if you start to get a hit, then the pharmas will come in with really large amounts.
So they'll back you up once they see something that has a lot of potential.
That's right.
Right. Okay. So, okay, here's probably the question I'm most curious about, and it's personal. So for a woman like me, and this, you know, speaks to my audience as a blogger for Breast in the City for women with breast cancer. So I had an initial diagnosis of stage 3. I did all the treatments. I had a double mastectomy. I did 6 rounds of chemotherapy. I did 25 treatments of radiation, and I had 3 reconstructive surgeries, and my 4th surgery is that I had my ovaries and tubes removed.
Mm-hmm.
All preventative measures.
Sure.
So God forbid the cancer comes back, which means it's goes from stage 3 to a stage 4 metastatic breast cancer, where it's spread to the most common areas, you know, but we'll say it for everyone, the lungs, the liver, bones, brain, and where else? Those, I think those are the most common areas. So that's a stage four, and usually a non-curable. Mm-hmm. So with what you're doing, is it too late for someone at a stage four having breast cancer?
Well, as we discussed earlier, you know, a lot of our trials are done in people who are very advanced.
Advanced stage.
And I think the promise of immunotherapy, which is still to be completely realized, is that even people with advanced disease could benefit from it. So what's really quite spectacular about your immune system,
yeah,
is that, you know, you get an infection from whatever source. You get a cold, you get different colds all the time. And those are different viruses or bacteria that infect you. When that happens, your immune system adapts itself and evolves. And it says, oh, this is a new virus. I got to change myself to attack the virus. Cancer, of course, is an evolving disease too. And what you're talking about is it changes.
Yeah.
So the beauty of it is that as the cancer changes, your immune system can evolve as well to match in lockstep with that change. And so it can keep attacking the cancer.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens though is that cancers find ways to shut down your immune system. They cloak themselves.
Mm. They're tricky little buggers,
they really
eh?
Are. And so they find ways to shut you down. So the new vanguard of immunotherapies are finding ways to revitalize your immune system, turn it back on. And since, you know, your immune system can evolve to just about anything,
mm-hmm.
if it gets turned back on, and if you can find ways to get around these things that the tumor is suppressing, then of course your immune system can attack it. And it shouldn't matter what stage you're at, it should be able to still do it, and hopefully, and your immune system's everywhere in your body.
Right.
So no matter where the cancer is, it can attack it. So I'd be optimistic.
Yeah.
That things are changing, and even if this should happen to someone, that they potentially could benefit from these therapies down the road.
Right. Okay. That's amazing.
Yeah.
As you know, my my husband was diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and leukemia, SLL and CLL. They're similar. Apparently, they're like cousins or something. So for him, he was a stage three as well. And it's a chronic type of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So basically, it's non-curable.
Mm-hmm.
He's had it for 9 years, so they were able to shrink it and keep it, you know, in place, intact, and he's followed up on and that sort of thing. But again, for him, it's not a question of if, it's more of when mm-hmm. will it come back. When will it act up again? It could be tomorrow, it could be in 20 years. They have no idea.
Right.
For someone like him, is it the same thing as for a stage four breast cancer patient? Like,
you know, I think it will be.
It will be?
I think so. I mean, I think there's reason, as I said, to be optimistic for many of these kinds of cancers. You know, I talk about immunotherapy as if it's something new, but reality is, you know, many people with leukemia get what are called bone marrow transplants.
Yeah, that's what he would have, and
yeah.
He's got his stem cell frozen.
Good.
They took it.
And what's that really doing is that's really rebooting your immune system.
Starting
so
all over.
It's immunotherapy, and it has been very successful. So I think that, you know, with these new therapies that are coming out, with these immune modulators, these antibodies and so on, or with the cell therapy like Carl June's doing, I think there's reason to think that a lot of these treatment cancers will still have another line of therapy available to people, and they will have good outcomes. I think that's coming.
Okay.
I'm not saying it's there yet,
yeah.
but I can feel that this is still coming. Yeah, so definitely, you know, keep the fight up.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah. No, it's great. It's great. All right, so we'll talk about Vice documentary, we've mentioned a couple times, but... So I watched this amazing documentary on HBO called Vice, a special report, Killing Cancer.
Mm-hmm.
It aired in February 2015, and you were featured, and you were actually, it started here, mm-hmm. where Shane Smith, who's from Ottawa, came here to interview you, and he described how you're basically the pioneer of this mm-hmm. whole...
Wow, it's a bit of an exaggeration.
Is it an exaggeration? Well, okay.
He's an Ottawa boy, so
I know,
he's
he wants to, it, yeah, yeah. But okay, but you've sort of pioneered, and you did discuss something really cool, which was how back in the day they found, this is how it first came about, where it was in prostitutes that they put in measles by accident, and then they discovered it cured ovarian cancer
or something.
Well,
yeah, it's a little bit confused.
Okay.
So, not bad, though.
Yeah,
so,
okay.
So what it was that... prostitutes would get cervical cancer because they were exposed to HPV infections because they were in the sex trade.
Right.
At the same time, they lived in squalor.
Right.
And so they would get vaccinated with a rabies vaccine.
Rabies, that's it.
Yeah, it's not measles, but close.
Did I say measles?
You said measles.
Oh, that's okay. Right.
Anyhow, and it turned out that at least in some of those instances, the virus that was found in that vaccine was able to attack their cervical cancer and sort of make them go into remission.
Wow.
And there's been other people who have shown the same sorts of things with things like mumps virus. Able to do this. So, and even further back, there was a fellow called Coley who developed what's called Coley's toxin, which is basically taking bacteria and inactivating and sticking it with tumors and stimulate the immune system. So there's been a lot of these things over the last probably 150 years that people have sort of developed and just hasn't really gotten to the surface.
Didn't get traction.
Yeah, it didn't get traction.
Right.
But now, with our more in-depth understanding of genetics and viruses and how they all grow and the immune system, we're able to actually put these things together. I think the Vice documentary was really well done, actually, and did highlight some of the great pioneers like Carl June, who did remarkable work with, and as did many others.
So is Carl June, the one in Philadelphia?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's what I want to ask you about. So that is what I found, I mean, besides it being like, oh my gosh, there can be a cure, this is unbelievable, but I found it fascinating that he injected the first pediatric patient,
right.
Emily Whitehead, with the HIV virus.
Mm-hmm.
And she was diagnosed when she was 5 years old,
mm-hmm.
and was doing chemo for 2 years and had two relapses,
mm-hmm.
and went from an 85% chance of survival to under 30. So she was really, you know, at the end. So this was kind of like a last hope for her and her family. So she was able to get into the trial, and they injected her with the HIV virus.
Well, they actually didn't inject with the HIV virus.
Okay.
I can see why you might make that mistake. What they actually did is they took out some of her own immune cells.
Oh, okay.
And then they used the virus to reprogram them.
Oh.
And they retrained those cells to now recognize her cancerous form. So it's a different kind of use of viruses. There's still viruses. We use a different kind of virus, one that attacks the cancer directly. What Carl did is he took a virus and used it to engineer.
Engineer the, but it was using the engine, not.
Yeah.
It's like collaboration is key.
Yes, absolutely. And it's almost on a daily basis, to be honest.
Really?
Yeah, we talk all the time.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, it really is good.
Yeah, I love to hear that because sometimes the perception is that like some scientists are like hoarding away their information because they want to be want the glory and be the first to discover. And you know, it's frustrating because, well, for anyone, like as a person, like why?
Yeah.
God, get together.
Absolutely.
Like, you know?
It's the way to make discoveries, there's no question. And I think in the particular field I'm in, the virus approach, we're even more so because we believe in this therapy.
Yeah.
And we recognize it's a long road, so we want to work together because we figure any one of us is successful, we're all successful. So I think it's a really great camaraderie in the whole field, and I enjoy working with all these guys from around the world.
It's fun. Oh, great. Good.
Okay, so let's fast forward down the line, and the vaccines are ready. They've been all approved, you know, you're ready, you know, it's going forward, as you did say with something else that's FDA approved, but of all your vaccines and stuff. So what would the timeline look from like diagnosis to treatment? Like, how would it change the timelines? So if, like for me, if I was Simone, you have, like I had a whole thing written out by the surgical oncologist. You have XYZ, this is how long you're gonna be in treatment, 9 to 12 months you're gonna have to take off work, we're gonna have to do this surgery, then you're gonna have a month in between. Like, they basically did a timeline for 12 months. So how would that timeline change from when you're getting the final results from the pathology?
Well, I have to only speculate.
Yeah.
But you know, the dream is that these therapies would be much less debilitating than chemotherapy and so on. I think surgery is probably going to stay because, you know, surgery is a very effective way to get rid of large tumors. It's probably the best way.
The best way, yeah.
So that may always be in play. The question is, can these new therapies replace chemotherapy? If they do, and if they're as safe as we hope they're going to be, then presumably the timelines would be much shorter and people would not be
hopefully not lose time from work. So
right.
that's one of the other dreams that we would have is
yeah.
that people would have normal lives and would not lose time from work or would have minimal loss of time.
Yeah.
But right now, that's still all hypothetical.
Right.
But that's just the thing that we have in our minds for what we'd like to achieve.
Right.
Those are good goals to go after.
Yeah. And you wouldn't have the same side effects.
That's
like, you'd be able to keep working, maybe, you know, maybe just a month off. I don't know. What do you envision? You can't say.
Hard to say. But, I mean, obviously,
yeah.
that what we would like to see
yeah.
is, of course, people have much better outcomes and have much fewer side effects. And that's really what all this work heading towards.
Okay. That's wonderful. Okay. So let's say that it's all in place, hypothetically, and I'm diagnosed, and instead of getting the lineup of the traditional therapies, they're going to go for the vaccine, injecting the vaccines. Let's say, and that doesn't work. So will the traditional therapies be the next course of action?
That's a
possibility. Is that
yeah.
what
I mean,
they
I mean,
envision?
Yeah, I mean, I think even in the short term, the reality is we have what we call standard therapies already.
Yeah.
And so we're going to use these new therapies in combination with those anyhow,
standard.
Likely.
Okay.
It's not going to be a real quick switch because it's going to take a long time to figure out how well it works. Even in trials where a drug is successful or a therapy is successful, you still don't know if it's going to be true when you expand to a larger population.
Right.
So you really have to go out to and see a lot of people treated. So nothing's going to be quick, to be honest.
Right.
And there's going to be always the and some cancers, maybe only chemotherapy or radiation therapy will ever work. That's possible.
Yeah.
We don't know.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of unknown stuff.
Right, because there's, from the Vice documentary, there's 300 different types of cancer, which I didn't
probably
even...
Probably way more than that, actually, because as we're talking about, our genetics is different, right?
Right.
And so every cancer cell is genetically different than someone else's cancer cell.
Right. It's, yeah, okay. So there's a ways to go, but there's so much hope. Like, you're on the board. I would say borderline a cure. I think the community's saying that, right?
I think that a lot of people are really benefiting from these therapies and have a long-term benefit. And I think that is certainly what we want to get to.
So can you say the word cure?
I can say it all I want. But I mean,
I know that researchers are hesitant to use the word cure.
No, I mean,
I work towards
cure.
Yeah,
there's no question that that's what I want to say.
Right.
And I don't work to have people have slightly longer lifespans. That's
yeah,
not my goal.
You want.
I do want to have a cure for this disease. And I think now, with more of these immunotherapies, and not just our work by any stretch, but around the world, there's so much momentum that I think we're starting to see people who are having long-term responses, which I would call potentially cures. So that's what we all want to be. I agree with you. It's sort of politically incorrect to say I'm daring to try for the cure, but
yeah,
you know, Terry Fox wanted us to get the cure.
Yeah.
He didn't want us to get the cure. So that's what we're all driven by.
Yeah. Wonderful. Okay, so I spoke to the producer of the Vice documentary, Killing Cancer. His name's Matthew Horowitz. He was very nice to talk to me. And the reason why I wanted to, because I think everybody should watch that documentary. Like I said, it was really amazing and it was easily understood and of what you and your colleagues are doing. So I asked him if you could ask Dr. Bell a question, since you've aired the documentary, what would it be? And he sent me two questions, and one, I find that the wording is difficult, but I will try to say it. So when we interviewed you for Killing Cancer documentary, you had genetically engineered the Maraba virus into metaphorical smart missiles to seek and destroy cancerous cells while leaving the healthy cells alone. Now that you've added a second virus, the cold virus, what properties does the cold virus possess, and in what ways does the second virus complement the attack of the first virus?
Okay, so this is a good question. So as Matthew mentioned, we started out with just one virus, we've now gone to two, and we think we'll actually build on that with other kinds of therapies as well. So my colleague and master, Brian Lichty, and another colleague, Yonghao Wan, both of the master, recognized these viruses were stimulating our immune systems. And so one way that, you know, when you were a young girl, you were vaccinated in your arm with vaccines, those were all based upon viruses. That's a really great way to stimulate your immune system. So we said, is there some way we can augment the activity of the first virus? And the idea was, why don't we use two of them? One is really priming an immune response, and the second one is boosting it up. And so that's what we designed as a strategy, where the first virus, the so-called cold virus, is injected into the patient's arm just to stimulate an anti-tumor immune response to get it started. And the second virus, the rhabdovirus, comes in and attacks the cancer and then boosts that immune response. So it's really a 1-2 punch. That's the idea. We're excited about that, and we're testing that for people, but we also think that overlaying that now with one of these immune modulating antibodies, like what people develop, should be even better. And so that's really the direction we're heading.
Okay, wonderful. So does that answer your question, Matthew? That complicated question. Okay, so he had a second question, and I think we might have talked a little bit about this, but what are the key obstacles that researchers still need to hurdle before oncolytic viral therapies or immunotherapies can truly defeat their intended cancers?
You know, it's complicated to get from the laboratory bench all the way into something that can be used all the time. There's a lot of things that have to happen. One of them is that we have to do a lot of clinical studies where we have to test the patients and see how well they work. So, you know, all my life is working with mice, which is sort of bizarre.
Gross.
Because, yeah, exactly. And I have to say, you know, I spent all day trying to save mice, like a whole night. My wife says, kill all the mice.
Oh no, in your house? You can set up the traps?
Yes, exactly.
Oh, could you hear them going in the middle of the night?
Yeah.
I've heard that.
Yeah, I actually sort of enjoy that. But anyhow.
Yeah. Okay, now that's bizarre.
Yeah. But anyhow, so no one wants to work with mice. We want to work with people. The,
right.
The value of mice is that they're inexpensive and they're all inbred. So they've been brother or sister mated for 50 years, so they're exactly genetically identical.
Okay. Oh, cool.
And so then we can ask questions of mice, but people were genetically different. And so what works in a mouse may not translate to a person. So we have to start testing people, finding out why it's not working as well in one and another. And then you can then re-engineer the virus so it can work in different kinds of people. So really doing a lot of clinical studies is essential. It costs a lot of money, and it costs a lot of people's time. And that's a huge hurdle that we need to continuously deal with, is getting more people all these trials, which cost, as I say, millions of dollars.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's slowing the process down, to be honest. If we can do that faster, we'd be probably better off.
Okay. Great. Well, I really enjoyed this.
Yeah, it's been fun.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
It's wonderful news. I'd like to thank you so much for taking the time to speak to me. It really means a lot. To me, on a personal level, but also to everyone out there. I think, you know, this is a topic that affects everyone worldwide, so, and you bring hope. You bring hope to patients and families and caregivers.
You know, and everybody actually contributes to this answer.
Mm-hmm.
So if we are lucky enough to be successful, you know, as I said, we've got donations from everybody around the world, basically. I mean,
mm-hmm.
Everybody's contributing to the solution, I think, by supporting cancer research. And, you know, I'm lucky to be recipient of all that, and
yeah.
A chance to test some of my ideas.
Yeah.
And work with some really smart people. So,
yeah.
I think it's everybody's. We're all playing our roles.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so too. I think, yeah. Good. Well, thank you so much.
Thanks so much.
You too.